Now, we're going to begin our program for the evening, where we're going to have the opportunity to listen to those people who have decided that they want to dedicate a large part of their life to children by running for state school superintendent. I'm going to ask them if they would, each of them, to come up and take a place where their name is. Mr. Bell?
The other one.
Oh, the other one.
In case you can't read their names, if you're like me and you can't see that far away, first, right there. We have Mary Kay Bacayao. Did I say that correctly?
Bacayao.
Bacayao, that's not, I thought that's what I said. Ashley Bell, Nancy Jester, and Richard Woods. Thank you all very much, and I'm going to turn the program now over to our moderator, who is Secretary of the Republican Party here in Forsyth County, Bob Rorke.
Are you all, can you hear me? Testing?
Yep.
Testing? Are we ready to rumble? Oh, that's the wrong announcer. Okay. Good evening. We do have some set rules I'd like to review with everyone to understand how we're going to go from one candidate to the other. And basically, we welcome you all here tonight to debate some very important issues for the state of Georgia. It all comes down to local school districts with the leadership of the state and how we're going to operate this is that we're going to have a 1 minute introduction by each of the candidates that are here. We'll start from my left and go all the way over to Richard. And then you'll also have a 1 minute close at the end of the evening for your closing statement. I will pose questions that we've developed with the input of several folks in the Republican County Committee. You'll have 2 minutes to respond to those questions, each one of you, and I'll try to rotate the beginning. So question number one, I will start with Mary Kay, then number two with Ashley and so forth, and we'll try to rotate it. And if I get out of order, make sure that you bring me back into order so I get the right rotation going. And then opportunity to have a 1 minute rebuttal after that main question has been answered by each of the candidates. So pretty simple, straightforward. And we'd like to start off with this question, if we may. And Mary Kay, you'll be the one to kick it off for us, if you would. Mary Kay, go ahead with your introduction and then we'll go down to Ashley and so forth.
Hi, my name is Mary Kay Bacayao. I'm here for academic freedom. That's what I'm running for state school superintendent to accomplish. I want the decisions to be made by the local school districts. I've served on a local school board, Fayette County School Board, about half the size of this county. And I've been a math education professor. I noticed that the standards were 1 to 2 years behind our former GPS standards. And on the Fayette County School Board, there was nothing I could do to stop the testing or the standards that were lower level. So I've decided that we need that academic freedom. I have 4 children in the public school system, and they need academic freedom too. So that's why I'm running, Dr. Mary Kay Bacayao, for academic freedom.
Thank you. Right, 1 minute, we appreciate that.
Thank you so much to the Forsyth County Republican Party for hosting this. Great opportunity for us to speak to you and the voters directly. My name is Ashley Bell. I'm from Hall County. Some of you may know me. I've had a radio show on WDUN, so this is in my listener group, so you may have made acquaintance over the airwaves. So it's very good to see you in person and good to meet you all. Well, I've been, as you know, a vice chair of the Hall County Commission. One of the few folks in politics that can say I cut the budget by 15%, and those commissioners out here can tell you that's difficult to do, and you had some leadership here in Forsyth that's been able to cut the budget as well. But cutting the budget 15% is real tricky. The only way you can really get it done is you gotta keep the federal government out of your budget. Currently, the Department of Education, 60% of the employees are exercising federal programs. That's a big problem. I run a charter school, I'm a chair at Gainesville High School, and we have local solutions to big problems, and that's where my experience lies. And also my wife, Lauren, who's sitting in the second row here, we run a nonprofit that focuses on graduation rates, focuses on doing everything we can to elevate and graduate our young people, because we know that's the biggest problem in Georgia, is making sure we can make sure every one of our students graduates with the best chance they can of succeeding in the workplace. Thank you.
Thank you. Nancy.
This is on. Okay, good. Hi, I'm Nancy Jester, and it's a pleasure to be here with you. Thanks for having me. I live in Dunwoody. I have three kiddos in public school right now in DeKalb County. I served on the DeKalb County School Board, where I was the first person to publish, identify, and alert authorities to $54 million in deceptive budgeting practices that wore away the accumulated cash reserves of the third largest school district in the state. That's your money, too. And it was an embarrassment what was happening, and it has motivated me to run for state school superintendent, because we are in the dark ages with how we account for money at the state level, and you deserve better. I've got a plan that deals with what I consider the five structural problems in education in the state of Georgia. It's called FOCUS, and I look forward to talking with you more about that tonight. You can learn more about my plan by going to nancyjester.com, and I look forward to discussing that more tonight. Thanks so much.
Thank you, and Richard.
Yeah, thank you for coming out tonight. My name is Richard Woods. Once again, I'm running for state school superintendent of the state of Georgia. I was a candidate, Republican candidate in 2010, so I'm back. But again, I'm back with a passion that allows me to say that, you know, I'm concerned about our children. And with our children, you know, what do we want them to achieve? And I think that's giving them a diploma. Not a diploma that is basically a piece of paper, but something that gives them opportunity. And it's opportunity that once they leave school, that they will be able to continue on and pursue their education, whether that be at the military, whether that be university, trade school, job training. Also give them the opportunity to have a gainful employment, to become our business leaders, and hopefully someday become small business owners. And then also have the opportunity to live a very productive and happy life as an American citizen. It is something we'll be talking about tonight, and again, something that I have passion and plan, what I call my C4 solutions. And again, I hope that I will have the opportunity to share those with you later on. Thank you very much.
Well, the candidates all passed the first test of the yellow card and the red card. So you all learned quickly, so that's a good sign. Yellow card for as you go through the next question means that you're almost over your time, so make your closing remark for that, and as the questions start here, we're going to have again 2 minutes, 1 minute, and we'll go through 2 minute response, and 1 minute rebuttal for those who want to rebut. First question is, if you are elected to the office of superintendent, how will Republican values influence your decision making? First question goes to Mary Kay.
I had a chance to run as a Democrat, and I declined because there was no way I was going to run as a Democrat. There's nothing in the Democratic platform that I agree with. I agree with everything in the Republican platform. We are against Common Core. I have the resolve to stop Common Core, and I have the knowledge to get us going in the right direction. I've been endorsed by Georgia Right to Life, and I've also been given the Education Liberty Award. Both of those are in line with the Republican platform. I have more time?
You can do it unless you hold up that red card.
What I plan to do is stop having the U.S. Department of Education, which is run by an Obama appointee, control what we do here in Georgia. Right now, everything is just passing through our State Department of Education. We don't have any local control. We need to be able to, at the State Department, make sure kids know how to read, and the local schools can determine what they read. We need to make sure they know how to do math, and that they're challenged at their appropriate ability level, not one size fits all. one-size-fits-all as a teacher of 25 years, I know that that doesn't work. Kids all develop, I have four children, they all develop differently, they all have different aptitudes, abilities, and interests. And unless we acknowledge that, our test scores will not improve. We will not be able to show growth. Until we can say no to the federal dollars, we're always going to be under their thumb. I'm willing to do that.
Thank you. Ashley.
That's a great question. You know, there's part of our Republican Party platform is against Common Core, the state level and the national level, and I am a constitutional conservative. I fundamentally disagree with the fact that the federal government tries to bait and switch us and buy their way into our local government and our local education. Being a county commissioner, I can tell you, I've looked at grants and all this federal money, and I've been able to look at it and say, look, thanks but no thanks, feds. Because every grant, every program that comes from the federal government comes with strains, and half the time it comes with chains. And those chains are what stop us from being able to have the local control we need to educate our children. Now, I'll make that practical for you and tell you an example of where I've shown leadership there. I chair a charter school in Gainesville. A charter school by law is a third teachers, a third parents, and a third business leaders. That public-private partnership there, that's what Republicans believe. We believe that you shouldn't just rely on government. You should invite the private sector in because that's where the ideas are. Two things we did in our charter school that you just wouldn't be able to do in a normal school. We required every one of our students to have a personal finance class that they pass before they graduate. Because until a student knows what a budget is and knows that money coming in has to be more than money going out, that's the bedrock of what's wrong with this country, is that people think the money's falling out of the sky and they don't understand what a budget is. And that's the problem with DC, and that's what we need to start and make good citizens who can make good decisions. The second thing we were able to do, no public school will be able to listen to community leaders and listen to our police department and say, actually, we don't want another Sandy Hook. We want to make sure that we have the proper ability to thwart some sort of attack on our students. We want to put rifles in our schools. First school in the state to be able to put rifles in our schools to protect our kids, because that was a local decision. Local control should be local educators and local leaders, not local bureaucrats.
Thank you very much. And thank you. And moving on to Nancy.
Thank you. I too am endorsed by Georgia Right to Life. I'm also endorsed by ethics leader Senator Josh McCune and former education leader, really, Senator Eric Johnson from Savannah. I'm proud of those endorsements. I'm proud that they know that I represent Republican values in all that I'm going to bring to the Department of Education. My focus plan is driven by conservative thought. The biggest problem in Georgia is how we are spending our money. We spend more per pupil than every state that borders us. We spend more per pupil than Mississippi. We spend more per pupil than Texas. Yet we get worse results. We have a lower graduation rate than every single one of those states, all of our border states, plus Mississippi, plus Louisiana, plus Texas. This has to end. And my the F in focus stands for financial integrity and accountability. We must adopt best practices. States like Texas are far ahead of us at this point. They have financial accountability measures that drive money into the classroom and away from bloated bureaucracies. If there's any doubt that we have allowed, in our Republican state, we have allowed bureaucracy to grow in unprecedented ways, and I mean to mitigate that immediately. We have had a 41% growth in student enrollment from 1992 through 2009. At the same time, we had a 74% increase in bureaucracy. It is choking the classroom. We can do better if we drive the more than adequate resources that we have into the classroom. My plan is very specific, and it will do so. We'll lower class size and create better results for kids and taxpayers around our state. That's Republican values, and that's what I'll do for Georgia.
Thank you. And Richard.
Again, going back to the original intent of the question, looking at, you know, Republican values, you know, and how it would affect my decision making. You know, one of the things I can look at is my past history. In 1980, when I graduated high school, the very first person I voted for was Ronald Reagan. And again, because of my commitment, because I understood the Constitution and appreciation of conservatism, you know, I'm proud to say that I've continued that vote throughout, you know, my adult life. And again, that is something, as your candidate in 2010 when I ran, you know, one of the things I shared with people is that, you know, I ran it on a platform that I was a Christian constitutional conservative. And because I was a constitutional conservative, you know, I was the candidate on the Republican side and again across the board, who led the fight against the encroachment of the federal government. Again, at that time, we had something called the Race to the Top grant, which, you know, Common Core was, you know, placed underneath that umbrella. But I was the only person on the Republican side that actually meant what he said and said what he meant. And so I stand before you today that as the first candidate to come out in for this race in 2014, you know, one of the things we look at was that my stand was common sense over Common Core. You know, I believe and firmly understand with the Constitution that, you know, that we have the right, the constitutional right, to determine, you know, what goes on in education in Georgia. It is not something that's given to the federal government. And so we need to make sure that we, you know, protect our constitutional right. Secondly, as we look at, you know, this, you know, being a Republican value, this is what I'm looking at as far as, you know, expanding and making sure that we are fiscally responsible. And that means one of the things that we look at for unfunded mandates. Unfunded mandates that have been passed down from the state and the federal level that we must reject. And we must make sure that if we cannot afford it, we do not need it. And that's just plain and simple. And I think finally looking at this, you know, looking at the creation of a purchasing consortium, something that puts business smarts into education smarts. And that way that we can pull our resources across the board and make sure that we are fiscally sound and spend our money wisely and collectively. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This question will...
Can we get rebuttal?
I'm sorry?
Rebuttal?
Yeah, okay. We'll go rebuttal, thank you. We'll start with you.
Okay, two things I heard concern me. Number one, public-private partnerships. Right now in education, we call that crony capitalism when we have Gates money combined with the U.S. Department of Education money and Pearson, a company out of the U.K. that's making all of the tax dollars, taking all of our tax dollars. So I am against public-private partnerships when it comes to crony capitalism. Number two, when you hear about a purchasing consortium, that's exactly what we have right now when we have all the tests, all the test prep, all the textbook materials, all owned by the same company. I reject that also. I am a Republican. I won in the primary at 68%. I called out a rhino. She switched to be a Democrat. And then I won against the Democrat with 65%, so Republican all the way. Thank you.
Thank you.
Exercise my 1 minute.
Absolutely.
And I agree with my good friend Mary Kay when it comes to crony capitalism, but let's be clear what I mean with public-private partnerships. I mean, we have to have partnerships with the local industry and local communities. That's the only way you're ever going to really have true progress with our CTAE. You can't sit around a table with just bureaucrats and figure this out, folks. What works at our school is the fact I have business leaders at our table. So a business leader is going to say, it doesn't do me any good to have a kid with calculus, best grade in calculus. That doesn't do me any good for my business. Do they know what a budget is? Can they stay live within their means? Those are the concerns that our business community has, and they need to have a seat at the table. And their seat at the table is a partnership. That partnership in education is the only way we're going to break out of this mediocre education system we have right now.
Thank you. Nancy, would you like to use your
minute? Sure. Well, one of the things I just like everyone to think about is the scalability of whatever we're talking about. Our state school superintendent has the largest state budget, oversees that. It's the single largest expenditure of the state. In addition, we're talking about over 111,000 teachers. We're talking about 1.7 million students. So anecdotes and ideas, you know, on the small scale are lovely, but they are not fundamentally going to change education in our state. We need to talk about large scale policy and issues that drive money into the classroom and results for kids and taxpayers. So think about that. Think about who has the aggregate solutions. Thank you.
Richard, would you like to have your 1 minute?
Sure. When we look at the purchasing consortium, again, part of my background was I was a purchasing agent for a multi-million-dollar national laser company. And really, when you look at that, that means allowing counties to pull their resources together to buy things in bulk. You know, it is not something that, you know, you look at because you still have the choice. But I assure you that when you look at counties, if you're a county here in Forsyth County and you're spending, say, trying to buy five buses, you get a price. But if you are out here with allowed to group together with multiple counties and we're buying 100 buses, you know, we can get a better price. I did that as a purchasing agent. You know, when we need to look at that and putting a business practice, a capitalistic business practice into play. It will help save money. You talk about, you know, during this bond resolution with technology and textbooks and things of that nature. If we pull our resources together and allow to have very cooperative and open bids, we can save money. That will save you money at the local level. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to go to question number two, and we'll start that with Ashley and rotate through. And the question number two is, what are your plans for recruiting and retaining the best teachers for Georgia's schools?
That's a great question. Oh, finally my mic is on. All right, here we go. Y'all can hear me. Teacher evaluations are critical because you want to make sure you're getting the best teachers and they're doing the best job. Educrats, who are the people who are bureaucrats in education, they're afraid of competition. You're going to recruit the brightest minds to education if you insert competition into the system. No one wants to think that they're going to get their best pay on their last year being in a job. They want to get paid for being good at what they do. So we have to change the antiquated system of just rewarding teachers for being there forever. Reward them for doing a good job. Pay for performance can work if you do it in the right situation. I'll give an example where I've seen it work and where we pushed it. Professional learning communities are an example. When we had a school that was Title I, and a lot of kids were from challenging communities and minority students, reading was a problem in one of our third grade schools. So one teacher was really good, and the other five weren't doing so good. So what we did is we created a professional learning community where you just didn't send those four teachers out to pasture because they weren't good. You took that one good teacher, and she met every Monday and Friday with those other teachers, and they came up with ways where she can share her techniques, share her best ideas, in exchange for trying to help those other teachers do better. And we compensated her for that extra attention and for that extra motivation. That's how you can insert competition and make sure the teachers want to teach. Because the best minds out there, they want to be in the private sector, because the private sector where you can get paid for success. We have to interject that same principle into education, and then you'll see even more teachers wanting to come into the system, because they'll know if they're great at what they do, they'll get the reward for what they earn.
Thank you very much, and Nancy.
Thank you. A couple of points. Remember earlier I talked to you about the bloat that we've seen in bureaucracy. I talked about the 41% increase in student enrollment and the 74% increase in bureaucracy. Well, let's talk about the big picture of that. Well, how has that affected the over 111,000 teachers in our state? Okay, if that had not happened, if we had kept bureaucratic growth to simply that student enrollment growth, that 41%, every teacher in the state of Georgia could have an $8,000 pay raise. That would be a very effective recruiting tool. And that's what I mean to bring to Georgia with my focus plan, because we are going to measure how districts are spending their money, just like states like Texas do. They have 20 indicators that drive money into the classroom, and if they have over 1,000 school districts in that state, and if they're not performing well under those 20 indicators, they can be called on the carpet about it, and there can be consequences for those district-wide failures. This is all part of my focus plan. And it is a path to helping all the districts around our state, the 180 districts that we have. It is a path that will help them recruit and maintain teachers, because they will have the money to do so when we quit bloating bureaucracy. It is not what we're doing now, so it is a complete paradigm shift. Another thing we need to think about just in the big picture is a firm, is a concept I call the teaching firm. And this is an article I published maybe a couple years ago about switching the way we think about schools and thinking about them as teaching firms, so that teachers stay there and have a substantial income growth there in the school, rather than having to move up into bureaucratic positions as the only way they can make more income. Again, let's think about these aggregate solutions and how much bureaucracy has cost us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Richard?
Again, I think you have to look at the very beginning and where we recruit teachers. That's at the college level. So we need to make sure that we are talking with our universities and the people that actually train the teachers that are coming into our system, to make sure that we are getting the personnel that we want. You know, so we talk about where schools are, you know, we contact, you know, or talk with business, the same should go with our educational, you know, program as well. So that, you know, is kind of the front line of that. But also, when we have teachers there, then across the board, we need to make sure that we support them, especially for me as an educator, an individual who worked in school for 22 years, You know, it was so important to have a good mentor teacher, you know, at the very beginning, to have a support system that allowed me to gain my craft. Because really it takes a, you know, a teacher, when you start them, it takes them about 3 and perhaps even to 5 years to really gain a grasp fully of what they are doing. So we need to have that support system in place. But for me as well, when I look at teaching, you know, one of the things I found, I just want to be able to allowed to close my door and teach. And so that means that we need to allow our teachers to do the things that they enjoy and want to do. We need to cut down the paperwork. We need to, you know, eliminate some of the testing, you know, some of the data collecting. Because the teachers did not go to school to become secretaries, you know, or somebody that is a data processor. They came to teach, so we have to allow them to do that. Also, we have to show them we respect and honor their position. You know, we need to make sure that the state eliminates furlough days. Because with furlough days, we prevent teachers from directing or interacting with our kids day by day. Because at the bottom line, we look at the testing situation as well, they're responsible for all the curriculum, regardless of how many days they're there. But I think also the way in which we have a testing system within Georgia as well. It needs to be structured so our teachers can actually evaluate to educate and not look at, you know, basically an autopsy at the beginning of the year or at the end of the year. So there are things structurally we can do on the front end, but also within the classroom to help them out and show them, yes, we do respect them. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Mary Kay.
In order to recruit and retain the best teachers, I've heard people talk about money issues. When I became a teacher 25 years ago, I didn't do it for the money. I could have done anything I wanted. I graduated at the top of my class. And I wanted to be a teacher. And the teachers out there that really care about the kids, that really want to help them, that's why they're teaching. Now we've seen what happens when we give money incentives in Atlanta public schools. It sometimes causes people to cheat. So money is necessary, but not sufficient. What is sufficient? I've been around the country as a consultant for school improvement to school districts that are failing. And when I go in and work with those teachers to try and help them make AYP, it used to be make AYP, I know what a good teacher looks like. For the past 10 years, I've been working at Mercy University teaching people how to be teachers, and I'm missing my class right now. My husband is teaching it for me. That is my heart, is to have the best teaching course. But to tell you the truth, we've got our best teachers leaving. They're leaving because the assessment system that they're being asked, the tests that they're being asked to give their students are not challenging those students. They're not able to meet their needs because it is a one-size-fits-all system. The whole school rating system, which doesn't even account for student achievement directly, it's frustrating to teachers that they're gonna be evaluated on things that their kids don't meet the needs of the kids. It's got to change. If it doesn't change, no amount of money can fix it.
Okay, now we go into the 1 minute rebuttal time frame, starting with Ashley. You want to?
Well, I agree with the teacher evaluations are a problem, but we have to make sure that we're keeping good teachers. But to recruit good teachers, people have to know that they're going into an education system where they'll be rewarded for being good at what they do. Not everybody is Mary Kay who can do what they want and decide to go into education. You got people going to the private sector who will be great, phenomenal teachers. And we have to create a window to bring people out of the private sector into teaching. Some of the greatest teachers we have in our technical education courses are people who have real private sector experience. That's what we're missing. And so to me, when we create these partnerships, and again, I go back to public-private partnerships, it works because if you look at CTAE, look at all the business leaders in your community who are helping out and who are in the classrooms who are getting real life experience. That's what we're missing, is that real life experience component in our classrooms.
Thank you, Nash.
Well, I believe that compensation is important. Labor markets equilibrate just like every other market. My degree's in economics, I know this. So it is important to attract the best and the brightest. It may not be, there are certainly other external factors, but that's an important one. And again, how we've been spending our money in the aggregate, the big picture, has really impacted our ability to pay the salaries that we should. Also, the evaluation system is just a complete waste of time. It is not actually finding the worst performers, and it is just burdening the best performers. It's a 358-page instruction document only from the mind of a bureaucrat to evaluate teachers. And so that needs to be looked at again so that we can have a much more streamlined, efficient way to evaluate our teachers and understand who our great performers are.
Thank you, Richard.
Okay. In order to keep our teachers, we've got to create an environment that motivates them to stay. I mean, roughly, you look at Georgia education right now, within the first 5 years, roughly 50% of the workforce leaves education. So we have to do things that support the teachers, and again, going back to some of the things we mentioned about, you know, cutting some of the paperwork and bureaucracy that they do have to deal with. You know, the teacher evaluation system that is up, you know, from a business perspective, it is a quality and control type evaluation system, which is great if you're trying to measure and look at the quality of manufactured parts, but we're dealing with individuals. You know, for myself as an administrator who had to go out and actually evaluate people, it was not that hard. You know, it means that you're out there and you're looking there day in and day out, and you're interacting with your teachers to know who's the very best. I mean, very simply, if you want to find out who your good teachers are, go to the front and ask the secretary. They know who your good teachers are. You know, we need to make sure that we have a system that is fair, that is equitable, that can be managed and not raise, you know, some of the output we have, but something that's very simple and show the teachers they are respected. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Mary Kay.
The career clusters, we're talking about CTAE, are copyrighted and owned by ACHIEVE, the same organization that owns the Common Core Standards. Local officials need to be able to innovate with career education that reflect local interests. For example, in Fayette County, we had a new partnership with Pinewood Studios. What we wanted to do didn't fit into the copyrighted and trademarked and almost written into state law career clusters. We don't need to have the federal government telling us what kinds of careers our kids can have. In Georgia, we need to break free of the U.S. Department of Education planning our economy. A planned economy does not work anywhere. It's socialism, and it's not what America is built on.
Thank you. We'll go to the third question, and the third question will start off with Nancy. The third question is, from your perspective, please explain to our audience the good, the bad, and the ugly of Common Core and what Georgia should do in this regard.
Well, I think Common Core is not a conservative idea. It's not a Republican idea. I like to explain it to folks, and I've been interviewed about it and written about it in the big picture again. And it's disappointing that we see so many Republicans support this idea. It is centralization. It's a standards bureau. We know that centralization and another layer of bureaucracy will not drive achievement. We know that. We're conservatives. So that is not congruent with our ideas. It's not compatible with school choice. It's not compatible with innovation. It's just a bad idea. And so I'm disappointed that so many of my fellow Republicans have embraced this idea. Furthermore, what I point out is a standard doesn't drive achievement. It is not a method. Hope is not a method, okay? What is the methodology to drive achievement? So I think people are promising something that won't be delivered. I think we are hearing from a lot of leaders that these standards are gonna somehow miraculously improve our achievement levels, and that's just simply not the case. Again, a standard is not a method. So, you know, in the state of Texas, for instance, they didn't adopt Common Core, yet they're outperforming us. Their job numbers, their economic development is so much better than ours. So we need to look at practices that actually do drive achievement. If just simply stating something, a standard or a goal of sorts, drove achievement, No Child Left Behind would have been a great success. It said by 2014, 100% of third graders would be proficient readers. Well, they're not. Saying it didn't make it true. So we need to be honest with folks about things that will drive achievement. Common Core isn't. It's not conservative. It's not a Republican idea, and I reject it.
Richard.
Again, the good, bad, and ugly. I guess, you know, if Clint Eastwood were here, that would be the good thing, that he could clean this mess up. But, you know, when we look at the good, you know, if there's anything that can be said with that, it did expose the intrusion of the federal government and the special interest. And that's about the only good you can say, that it has brought that into the forefront so that we can be very mindful. It has created an atmosphere in which people at the local level have become very interested and active in their education system, which is good because we need people at the local level to become active, to become involved in their school systems across the board. Now, as you look at the bad, you know, again, when I ran in 2010 as your candidate, you know, I spoke out against the No Child Left Board, again, No Child Left Behind, but more importantly, for the Race to the Top grant, which Common Core is embedded. And again, one of my greatest fears at that time was the constitutional issue. Again, if you look at the Constitution, the federal government has no right, according to Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution, to be even involved with education. That is something that was reserved to the states and more local, more importantly, at the local level. Also, what does the Common Core bring us? It brings us a lot of unfunded mandates. Unfunded mandates either from the federal government or the state government that is passed down to the local level. Now, you look at things, what will we have to pay for? You know, pay for a new testing system, implementation, teacher training, new teaching instructional materials. You know, things that will constantly be tweaked. Now, if you look at the special interest groups that are behind some of this, again, they want this system to always continue to perpetuate itself. Whether it's the Gates Foundation, whether it's, you know, looking at Pearson, who was over, you know, much of the testing and book companies, you know, they want us to be in No Child Left Behind and Common Core for perpetuity, so that we never run out of federal money for them. So we have to look at that and work on, focus on something that does work. You know, we have to be very mindful about data tracking as well. The only information that needs to be spread between a school and a system, you know, is between the parent, and that's where we need to keep it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Kay.
My battle started 2 years ago. I'm a female version of Clint Eastwood against Common Core. When I cornered the governor, and I said, this is a can of worms, it needs to stop, and he blamed it on the state legislature. All that time I was fighting, we sent 6,000 of these Stop Common Core postcards to the governor, and we got no reply. And you know what we got? We got a fake Common Core withdrawal bill called Senate Bill 167. Did you read the bill? We thought it was gonna get us out of Common Core, but when you actually read it, all it was gonna do is set up another bureaucracy of appointed people that we're just gonna go and reapprove of Common Core. So I spoke out against it. It was actually gonna take us in the wrong direction because it was gonna require us to add science and social studies Common Core if that bill had passed 167 and House Bill 897. So you could not have a person more opposed to Common Core, and not only just opposed to it philosophically, but from a knowledge base of analyzing every single standard and knowing what's missing. People come to me and they say, what do I need to do? Common Core. Do this instead, because this is what your child is missing, because they're not getting this in Common Core. I will not stop the group that I'm with. We will not stop until we have our educational system back from the federal government. This is the issue. It's the freedom issue in our country, because once we lose control of our schools, we lose our kids, we lose our country.
Thank you.
Thank you. You know, I'm against Common Core, but I have to give you a practical view as a charter school chair of why this is bad. It's good to say you're against it, but we have to have folks who are on the ground who are trying to fix the wasteland that Common Core has laid out in education. The Common Core rollout is 10 times worse than Obamacare's rollout. You know, I start with this. You know, the smartest kids in Georgia are smarter than the smartest kids in New York or California. Where we're behind is that bottom third. That bottom third of our students, that's where the problems are. And you and I know that the problem with that bottom third starts at home. It's a problem at home. So when I held a public hearing on Common Core at my charter school, I sent a robocall out to all the parents. Let's talk about Common Core. Curriculums are changing. You know, we had dozens of parents showed up. Nobody showed up with their Stop Common Core signs or Get the Federal Government Out of Education signs. The problem that we had there was our parents were saying, actually, you know what? I can't afford a tutor like some of these other parents. I can't afford the latest technology. But I can't sit around the table with my son and help him with his math, because I don't know what they're asking me. I don't know. I don't understand. 2 + 2 used to be 4, but now 2 + 2 has an 8-step portion of it. So if you say 4, that's half the right answer. But if you don't get the other 8 steps, you don't get the full credit.
How can you expect that bottom third not to rise like a high tide if you don't put parents in a situation to help their kids? It is almost a crime when you sit and you tell a parent that this new curriculum is right for their child and they're left helpless. We have to start at home. And Common Core is doing the worst thing possible, is to tear parents away from their ability to help their children.
Thank you. We enter the 1 minute rebuttal time. Nancy.
Thank you. I would just say I do have also grave concerns about the collection of data on children. That's a big issue for me, so I want to say that. And also, I'm wary of focusing on the bottom third from a policy perspective. That is where we've gone wrong with No Child Left Behind and all these programs. We focused on mediocrity and getting the below the middle up. And I have plans and policies that float all boats. They help everybody, so we're not picking favorites and pushing money into only certain areas where we ignore our gifted population, where we ignore kids that are really high achievers that can be pushed more. So I have a plan that, again, invests in such a way that it floats all boats. We're not going to marginalize people just because they happen to be smart or they're in a better socioeconomic setting. The superintendent cannot fix families, but they can fix policies that help all children achieve. Other states have bad parents too, but they're achieving more. Why are they doing it? It's not because they are fixing the socioeconomic problems in their state. Thank you.
Richard. Again, looking at some of the you know, what do we need to improve education, you know, to go beyond this? And I think as an educator, one of the things I found out is we need to make sure that we do actually personalize education, not standardize it. You know, our kids, and again, one of the issues with Common Core, you know, is it one size fits all? And of course, we know it does not. You know, but that means that also with our kids, we need to make sure that we're giving them the firm foundation. You know, K-5 education is so critical, and it is something where we have to have the flexibility to take the kid where they are. But also it means that, you know, we give our kids that solid foundation in reading, writing, and math. You know, by the time they leave fifth grade, so that they can have the opportunity and we can offer them the choices across the board. But one of the things as well that when we look at this issue, you know, we need to make sure that we, you know, provide our kids with a strong literacy program. You know, literacy is something that's very, very important. One of the components that is probably left out more so than any. Because if we can teach our kids to read and read with comprehension, give them some ability to have books in their hand prior to getting into school, then the issue of standards begins to take care of itself. Because if we are doing the things right in education, I don't care what our standards are, you know, we will be providing our kids with the education they need.
Thank you, Mary Kay.
On the Fayette County School Board, I spoke up and I spoke up with my vote against everything Common Core and against every test related to Common Core. When I qualified for state school superintendent, I was automatically off the board. My daughter is in seventh grade. I sent a letter to her school opting her out of the test because that's how strongly I know and believe that the test is not an effective test and it's actually misrepresenting information to parents. She had to take it anyway because of the state and school policies. If I'm state school superintendent, the test will be the appropriate test that will test reading level, math level, problem solving, verifiable science, writing, things like that. That's what we need, and that's what I'm going to do for my daughter, for our four kids, and for everybody's kids.
Thank you. I think we have one more rebuttal. Great.
Thank you. You know, the first thing we have to do also is end the lie that Common Core helps you compare apples to apples from one state to the next. That's just absolutely not true, and I'll tell you exactly how. If you take the math ELCT, the end of course test, the math test that's given out by the state, is Common Core driven, 65 questions are on that test. Those 65 questions, as you know, were sent out across the state, students took the test, almost 40% of our kids didn't pass this stuff. Almost 40%. But when they sent their tests off to the state looked at this and they said, you know what, we can't fail all these students because you'll be in an uproar. So what did the state do? The Department of Education took those 65 questions and said, you know what, 23 is gonna be our cut score. 23 is gonna be what passes. So as soon as they got more than 23, they passed the ELCT. However, in South Carolina, they got the same problem. Kids in South Carolina took the same set of tests, but they made their cut score 29. So if a C is not the same C in South Carolina and Georgia, neither can a B or neither can an A. Every state is picking their cut scores to curb Common Core, to hide the failure of this policy. And as long as they're doing that, you will never have apples and apples, you have nectarines and bananas.
Thank you. We're going to go on to the next question. I'll be glad to repeat it. It's a two-part question, here we go. How well are the state of Georgia's investments in special needs populations such as special education and English language learners meeting the needs of those students? How would you shift investment to focus on high impact early interventions with the greatest potential for positive outcomes? Would you like me to read it again?
I think we'll address special ed and English language learner. Again, with both of those subgroups, we know that if you were to look at our state testing, you know, those are two areas that are probably the most hardest hit. For me as an individual who worked in a small school system, those were the two groups that potentially had the greatest failure that would make sure that, or would ensure that our school would not meet our testing requirements. So we do have to look at that. Now, how do we make the adjustment there? Now, with special needs, one of the things you look at, and one of the things that Texas is doing, is that they base their graduation of their kids based on their IEP, or their individual education plan. Now, within Georgia, all of our special needs kids have to take the same test and everybody's on the same level. So really, you know, you think about what does that test actually mean? For a special needs kids, it really means nothing. So we need to look at how we are providing services for those kids. Also, when we look at testing and, you know, in cooperation with our English language learner, you know, we need to have the flexibility at the local level to not only take that child, but any child where they're at. Now, going back to, you know, K-5 program, you know, reading and English language arts is very critical. If you have kids that cannot read, you know, the heck with the standards, you know, that are set there for a grade level. Because if your child is in third grade and they're not reading at third grade level, those standards mean nothing. So our local schools have to have the flexibility to take that need and to adjust, you know, their curriculum and their standards to meet the needs of that kid. And so that's where I would look at, especially the K-5 area, that is, instead of just a grade level promotion, let's have a sliding promotion, something that's based, you know, really on proficiency. This allows our teachers and our schools to better address the needs of the individual kids and to move forward. So don't be rigid, don't, you know, put everybody in the same box, because it will not work. I saw it, you know, No Child Left Behind, we're heading down the same path. Thank you.
Very good.
I'll talk about special education first. At Mercer, we do have a program in early childhood special education, and that's the program that I have been teaching in for the past 10 years at Mercer. And what I've noticed with the testing is that instead of giving kids an appropriate test on the CRCT, we're just giving them bonus points. It's so random, it's so arbitrary, and they're suffering through these tests. Some of them, you know, they can't even read the test, and they're having to sit there and take the test. It's not right. We need to give them an appropriate test, which would be a diagnostic test, instead of, you know, doing the one-size-fits-all that's coming down from the USDOE. The other thing I want to talk about is ESOL. I do teach a class in the ESOL endorsement online for Mercer University, and so that is also an area of expertise for me. What we have right now for ESOL is a wonderful program where it is a diagnostic kind of placement testing, where they rate them in their reading, speaking, writing, listening abilities according to a diagnostic test. And then from there, the test is called the WAP test. It's a WITA test. And what they do is they specifically give them a diagnostic program where they're meeting those students' needs, where they're at. When ESOL students come in, they usually are quiet for a little while when they get used to the language, and then later on they start to want to communicate. So I'm really happy with what's going on with the English language learners right now in the state of Georgia, and it's just a shame that it's not happening with some of our other programs, because our gifted students at the elementary level in particular are not being challenged. We need to challenge all our students, challenge 100% of our students.
Thank you, Ashley.
The special needs, children with special needs, is going to be a critical issue going forward, because this is the toughest part of our teacher evaluations. What teachers are being asked to do right now is being judged on growth. They look and say, all right, well, you started with students at point A, and how far did you get them? Did you get them to B or C by the end of the year?
How difficult is that going to be for our teachers who are teaching special needs? But they're being on the same evaluation system as every other teacher. That's the first thing the DOE needs to address, is making sure that those teachers who are good at what they do aren't put in a situation to fail. And when it comes to ESOL, I'm going to tell you, my district, where I charter school, is definitely at least 50% first-generation Americans. We just don't make any excuses, folks. If you got here and you're from another country, you need to catch up as soon as you can and get in the classroom and produce. Because those teachers who teach ESOL, you know what? They have those same teacher evaluations. And we have to have a flat sign that says no more to D.C. when it comes to refugees. When it comes to sending folks to our districts from D.C., we need to say no, because it's not coming any more money and it's straining the rest of our kids who are there trying to learn.
Thank you, Miss.
Well, there's a couple of innovations that we can capitalize on from a state's perspective. You may recall some years ago, the state of Georgia passed SB 10, which is the Special Needs Scholarship Program. That needs to be expanded and perhaps enriched, because so you've got students who, with their IEPs, can leave the public school system and go into a private school that specializes in helping that child with their particular special need. That then takes a very expensive education out of the public school and puts it into a private school that's innovating and delivering more tailored services for that child. It is changing lives, and it's a very good financial deal for school districts. And we need to look at again expanding that and enriching that. One of the things we can do with ELL is, again, school choice and charters are something that can drive improvements for our English language learners. We've got language immersion charters coming out. That's a really good place to, help students feel at home in their native language, but then at the same time acquire the needed skills in English. Those are programs that can innovate as well. School choice can drive innovations in both of these areas, our English language learners and our special ed. So we need to start expanding school choice. We need to look at best practices from other states, states that have a large population of English language learners, like our border states. And there are districts in Georgia that are doing a better job than others in specific areas like special ed or English language. So we need to share best practices around the state, and that is something that the Department of Education, the superintendent, can offer leadership in doing, so we're not so siloed like we are currently. Thank you.
Thank you. 1 minute rebuttal, Richard.
Okay. Again, one of the biggest things we need to look at as far as education in this area is that our decisions do not need to be money driven. So much when you look at class size and class organization, the model from our QBE program is really money driven. It's not necessarily we're making the best decisions based on the need of the child. But we can do some things across the board to incorporate some things for all of our kids. Give them multiple diplomas, expand our diploma selection, whether it's a special needs, general, technical, vocational, STEM, whatever, that would help out. Giving courses that expand opportunities, so some of these kids that perhaps that they can, perform, in things of our trade school, whether it could be welding, whether it could be ag, and things of this nature. But also across the state, one of the issues I've looked at that many parents have asked is that, Richard, we'd like for our kids, again, those that are proficient in English, to learn a second language. Well, perhaps, we could look at, what we're offering in some of the dynamic makeups of our classes or schools, and perhaps, the solution is right there, where we have two existing languages that we could perhaps teach and have a benefit for all kids. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Jane.
I have taught ESOL students and special education students and a whole class of behavior disorder students in Newark, New Jersey. So the state school superintendent needs to have these kinds of experiences so that they will know what's going on out there in the classrooms. I had a behavior disorder student tell me, "Oh no, I can't behave because I have a behavior disorder." Are we telling these kids that they have a behavior disorder and using that as an excuse so that they won't behave? I hope not. And there's a line item in the budget, in the state budget, for any special education student that is costing more than $27,000 a year. Now, as a Republican, how can you have a student, that one student costs $27,000 a year? We can't let those kind of abuses go on. And what that the reason why that happens is because our policies say everyone has to be the same. But that's not realistic.
Thank you. Don't get my 1 minute. Go ahead. Thank you. When it comes to special needs children, far too many times their parents are being turned away. We all know that the federal and state law says you have to accept special needs children, children with special needs. So far too many times schools are saying, we don't have the program, we can't fully execute this IEP, and you have gaps there. You won't fix this problem unless you start letting the money follow the child instead of going to the school. If the special needs child, no matter what that number is, could take that money, and that mother could take that child to any school and take that money with them, okay, all of a sudden you'll see a lot of schools who want to have that child come in. But as long as money's just going to the school, you won't create the competition in the marketplace so that children with special needs will be wanted in different environments and wanted to be in certain schools. So that's the first step. But people say vouchers are bad, but I'm gonna tell you, the GI Bill was a voucher, Pell Grants are a voucher. They are the answer when it comes to specifically with students who have special needs.
Thank you.
So when I talked about SB 10, that is the special needs voucher. We do have that. We do have that already in our state, and that's what I was saying. We need to expand that and enrich that. And we are seeing innovation in the private sector with that, because we do have it in special education where that money can follow the child. Right now in the state of Georgia, it's one of the best things we do. We need to continue to expand that. You see places like Sophia Academy inside the metro area, and they offer a wonderful resources and curriculum and classes for students that have learning challenges. So we need more of that, not less, and they're delivering that product at a lower cost per pupil than oftentimes the school district is doing so. So again, that will drive innovation. It will improve our districts overall by taking away some of the most expensive things that we're doing. So again, SB 10, we really need to look at improving, making that better, expanding it.
Thank you. Well, for the next question, we'll start again with Mary Kay from the beginning. And the question is the following. How will you work with the legislature to improve education in Georgia?
I've already done this because I've worked with the legislature this past legislative session and spent so many days at the Capitol communicating with the legislators. I did a thorough study of House Bill 897, and I discovered all kinds of things in that bill that weren't going to be beneficial for Georgia students. They were going to take out separate reading tests. They were going to take out separate writing tests. They were going to expand Common Core to include science and social studies. I was able to go to 6 of the 8 listening sessions around the state as a school board member, and I spoke during the school board member time to tell them about what's happening with our accreditation system, a crony capitalist system that is connected to Common Core and purchased and owned by private entities. I spoke with the governor. I alerted him to the problems with House Bill 897, and he heard me, and he put back the writing test, and I'm so glad House Bill 897 didn't pass. So many of our activists worked against that bill passing, and we did stop the further implementation of Common Core through that bill. That's my mission, that's my plan, to return local control to the local school systems, because we didn't have it in Fayette County, and that's where it should be. Parents, teachers, and locally elected officials, they need to be the ones deciding, making these decisions, not Atlanta and not DC.
Thank you, Ashley.
Education policy in this state is a team effort. You'd be kidding yourself if anyone up here was to say that they could single-handedly do anything. Because the biggest problem in our state, if you were to ask the education professionals around this country, what has held Georgia back? What specifically is Georgia doing that keeps us 49 or 48 when it comes to education? They'll tell you the long and storied history of your state school superintendent being at odds with your governor. That's where it starts. Nobody else has that sort of riff with a long history, highlighted by the fact that we're up here being able to run for office because of it. To be honest with you, the governor, the legislature, the Board of Education, and your superintendent need to be on the same page. They got to be around to be able to sit around a table and say, here's the vision that we have going forward, and everybody work for that vision. Yes, you're going to disagree, but do you have the experience of working at that level? I have. I'm from right across the pond in Hall County. The governor was one of my constituents. I know what it's like to put a big issue on the table and figure out where things can work and disagree and still move on to agree again the next day. There's no more important issue than getting this state on the same page with your top elected officials, and that involves the whole team, not just the legislature, but all the parties involved.
Thank you, Commissioner.
One of the reasons you've seen the conflicts, I think, between the various branches of the superintendent and then the executive and then the legislature is because the folks that have continued to hold the superintendency have been bureaucrats, and they're not really, you know, they may be Republicans, but they still protect the educrat class, the bureaucratic class. And so we saw that in the charter school amendment bill, and so they're at odds with things that will really reform, because that really is going to take a hit to bureaucracy. We're going to start getting money out of bureaucracy and put it in the classroom. So they know that. Okay, so they're protecting their turf. That's why they're at odds. When you elect someone like me to state school superintendent, I am going to be aligned with folks that want to improve education and outcomes for kids and taxpayers. And so I'm going to bring to the legislature policies that do that. That will make them look good in their district when we start doing better and paying less for it and putting the money in the back pockets of teachers instead of bureaucrats. Folks at the legislature are going to be real happy with what's going on at the Department of Education. And so that's how we're going to get on the same page. My focus plan involves the legislature because the O is expanding opportunities and school choice. I want to work with them on that. I think we've got a lot of friends doing that. I want to work with them on consequences for district-wide failures. That's the C. We have to work with them to upgrade our funding formula. It goes back to 1985. It's got to be truly per-pupil funding that attaches to a child and follows them to their choices that they have. And that's going to be something I'm going to work with the legislature on. And I was actually asked to run for this position by a legislator. And so they had the courage to say, you know what, I think you're the right fit, Nancy. And I've got legislators right now that have endorsed me as well. So I'm very excited to work with them to improve the educational lives of Georgia's children and make all of them look good.
Thank you, Richard.
You know, one of the keys we look at, you know, for this position, you know, we're talking about the state superintendent of schools. Well, that means you have to have wisdom. Wisdom that comes from, you know, dealing with policy or evaluating policy such as that I have. For 22 years, you know, I've worked in the Rorke County school system. Pre-K through 12th grade experience, 14 years in the classroom, 8 years in administration, you know, across the board. And each and every day, I dealt with parents, I dealt with our kids, I dealt with our teachers. Well, guess what state policy deals with? It deals with, you know, our teachers, it deals with our parents, it deals with our kids. And so you have to have somebody that can look at what we are talking about and make sure the numbers actually add up. You know, there are a lot of things that we could talk about, whether it's graduation rates and things of this nature, or looking at the expenditures. But if the numbers aren't factually presented, if they're not true, then, you know, you have to have somebody that can wade through that. You know, one of the things I've looked at that with an individual that, yes, I can work with the team. You know, I worked in a system that had over 100 very strong-willed South Georgia women. And again, and I can tell you for the fact, you know, to get those ladies to work together, to move together in a correct manner, you know, so that we could be productive as a team, you know, takes some effort. And so that is just something that I bring, you know, as far as looking at dealing with individuals, dealing with personalities as a coach as well. You know, one of my things that I looked at is I had to create a plan and present it, and again, so that we move together as a team. And for me as an administrator, that meant I was working with teachers, I was working with parents, I was working administrators above me. And so that experience is, you know, is insurmountable. It is something that we need in this position. You know, and I will commit myself not to run for any other political office, but I will commit myself, you know, until the people of Georgia decide different, that I will be the state school superintendent. because our position here needs stability. We have not had that. And so that is my pledge to you that I give tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Then we go to the 1 minute rebuttal round. Mary Kay.
I've been at the same job for the past 10 years. I wasn't looking to leave my job. I wasn't looking to leave the Fayette County Board of Education. I was very happy there. But I am not connected to anybody. I'm not connected to the governor. I'm not connected to any of the legislators. I'm not connected to the state school board members. We have a very unusual situation in our state where we have an appointed group called the State School Board who is directing and dictating what elected people at the local level are doing. And I will call them out on that every single time because it is wrong, it is anti-American, it is anti-freedom. And if it, when it comes to the team that I'm on the team of parents, teachers, students, and locally elected officials. And that's the team I'm playing for. I am not on this other team, the big money funded team. I'm on the grassroots team. And I hope that you all will join me on that team.
Thank you. Ash.
We're living in a new day as far as education reform. What we're seeing in our state that's happening now, we haven't seen it before. There's always changes and ebbs and flows in education. But when it comes to teacher evaluation, that's new. The creation of charter schools in that state, that's new. When it comes to dealing with those issues in the forefront by June 15th of next year, every system in this state's got to figure out whether or not you're going to be a charter school, IE squared, or stay the course. I've had the experience of working at the ground level with everything that's new that's going on in this state. I don't have a lot of experience about the old way of doing it because we know what that got us. But we are where we are. And we have to go forward with people who understand how this affects parents. And I can bring that experience to the superintendent's office of every day showing this policy that you have in Atlanta is not playing out how you think it is. And I can tell you how and I can tell you why.
Thank you.
So I've researched and published and given speeches around the state about what really drives achievement in other states and why we're falling behind, and it's affecting us from an economic development perspective as well. So tax climate and education systems, these are the big drivers, and we're losing to states around us in both of these. We're making some strides with our tax climate, but we have to do much better there, the educational system as well. So the question was, how will you work with the legislature? Well, I will come up with policies and ideas that are congruent with what the legislature wants as well, because they want a successful, productive, smart, educated Georgia. And that's what we're going to give them by bringing to the table the best ideas from around the nation and around Georgia as well, that's going to drive achievement for Georgia's kids and provide a higher rate of return for the taxpayers.
Thank you. Richard.
You know, whether it's people in the General Assembly or this office in particular, you know, one of the things you're looking at is that we represent you. And at the bottom line, when I say that I'm talking or working with the legislature, you know, that means I'm working with you. And so, you know, my pledge is to reach out to you at the grassroots level to hear what you're saying. You know, to make sure not to tell you how to run your education system here in Forsyth County, but to help you run that. And so that is so very important that we look at that, so that we have that pure line of communication that goes on between us. Because if we're doing that, and if we as your elected representatives are listening, you know, because what I know in my position, when I come to you and we're talking, then you are talking to your local representatives. And that means that when we talk together, you know, we have the voice of the people. So we need to make sure that we look at that and make sure that we are representing, you know, the voice of you. And that is my pledge to do that as well, because that is critical and communication is critical. That means both of us talking together. Thank you.
Thank you. So many questions, so little time. We have closing remarks now, and we'll just go in the order we were going in for 1 minute closing remarks, starting with you, Mary Kay.
I really thank you and appreciate you for being here, because you really care about the kids and you really care about what's happening in Georgia. I'm willing to sacrifice and do this job and fix the things that need to be fixed, return local control to you, to the parents. I'm talking about the wisdom of Solomon, where the moms, they care more than the people who aren't moms. We don't need this whole hired hand situation. We need the actual moms and locally elected officials and local teachers who care about the kids. Those are the ones we need making the decisions. And I'm ready to make sure that that happens. I'm ready to not take the federal money and have the knowledge and the expertise to bring the local elected officials and the local representatives to the State Department and let them run it instead of letting DC or the legislature or the governor run it. I want to do what you want for your schools, and that's where my heart is. I always wanted to be a teacher. I've done it for 25 years. I know what it takes to be successful, and I hope that you put your trust in me to fix these mess that we're in.
Thank you all for being here today. It's truly been a pleasure. Again, my name is Ashley Bell, and I chair a charter school in Gainesville for a reason, because my kids are in public school, and it means a lot to me, but I'm about solutions. Everything I've told you tonight has been about looking at a problem and finding a solution. Now, I know everybody wants to have a big theoretical conversation about policy, and the Department of Education is a good place to start with that policy. But at the end of the day, if you don't know how those policies are affecting parents, then it doesn't matter. You just have someone else up there again creating more bad policy. I'm from Hall County. I've been a vice chair of a commission over there. I know what it's like to cut the budget. You can talk a lot about finance, but at the end of the day, where's your experience in cutting budgets and cutting government? We've been able to do that because we know that you can't cut a government's budget if you have the federal government with chains wrapped around you. We gotta stay free, we gotta free our kids. My wife and I have been spending 10 years focused on a nonprofit that promotes graduation rates. Folks, if kids aren't graduating from high school, then that's the end of discussion. They won't make $216,000 as much as their next peer who graduates college. They'll be more than likely to be on the welfare dole. And that's where we have to focus. We have to focus on all our kids, but the biggest thing in Georgia, our biggest problem, is the kids that we leave behind. And I won't do that. Failure, it's just not gonna be an option.
Thank you.
Yes,
sir.
So the single largest expenditure of our state is our K-12 education. I'm the person running for this position, state school superintendent, that has had the most experience in dealing with anything as large as the budget for the Department of Education. I managed one of the largest trusts in the state of Texas when I worked as an actuarial consultant. I found $54 million in fraud that wore away the accumulated cash reserves of the third largest school district in the state. That was your tax dollars, and I stopped it from happening. You know what you're gonna get from me. I've gone all over the state and I've talked about best practices financially and policy-wise that drive results for kids and taxpayers. You know what? I'm a mom of three, Georgia, Jackson, and Jake Jester. They are in fifth, third, and first grade, and you bet I know the implications of the policies and the poor financial decisions we've made. My fifth grader has been in a trailer for years because of poor financial management. That must stop. The state has a role to play, and I intend to play it because I'm a mom, and I do know exactly how these things affect our babies, and I am going to drive results for kids and taxpayers. You can take that to the bank.
Thank you.
Again, thank you each and every one of you for showing up tonight. It is indeed a pleasure to be back up in Forsyth County. But again, once again, I'm running for state school superintendent. It is a passion of mine, education. I've worked for 22 years. And again, the only candidate that can actually say that I have been in pre-K through 12th grade at the school level. 14 years at the classroom, 8 years in administration. Serving as assistant principal, principal, K-5 curriculum director, system homeschool director, system hospital homebound director, middle school, high school, alternative school principal. You know, so each and every day, I've had to deal with the policies that have come from the federal government, that have come from the state. Each and every day, I've worked with our parents, our kids, and our teachers. You know, I know the things that work in education. If you go to my website at woodsforsuper.com, you will see my plan. It is simply called C4 Solutions. It addresses the child, it addresses the teacher, it addresses the classroom, it addresses the fiscal issues that we face in Georgia. You know, again, you have my pledge that I will not run from this position. It will be something that I will be here and I will make sure that I will not leave until the job is done. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you for your dedication, your passion, and your love for our children and grandchildren. And what you're attempting to do. Thank you very much for a great interchange.
Thank you.
And every one of you for caring enough about children and our family and our state. Cumming, we really you provide information on that for us. We appreciate it. I want to remind you that Monday night we're having another debate. This one will be for State Senate and for State Rep between Mark Hamilton and Sherry Gilligan. And I would also like to let you know that Fitz Johnson, who was also a candidate for State School Superintendent, was supposed to be here tonight, but he's unable to be here because his mother is gravely ill. So our prayers are with him. Blessings to all of you. Have a safe journey home, and thank you for coming tonight. And to you all, too.
Well, thank you for your dedication there.
We had a great time.
Thank you for the opportunity. Hey, enjoy it.
I'm going to put it again.
Is that going to be of service for being on the road?
Nope. You bet. Appreciate you coming down.
Good job. This is the least amount of candidates we've had anyway, so we got a ton of lots. The owners of my candidate is coming to the next one. Hey, yo, man, how you doing? Good to see you.
Oh, yeah. I did. Yes, I did. It's God's country.